Good morning and welcome to our worship from Trinity and Tunley, all you disciples of Christ. It may seem strange to be called disciples, but if you are a follower, a learner, a student, someone who is inquiring about Christ, then you are a disciple. And what Jesus calls us as disciples to do is to tell others about him and about God's glorious world. We hear of both in our worship this morning. Today is a day when we celebrate the Trinity of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And in our 40th year at Trinity, when we should have been having so many celebrations, it's right that we remember the Trinity with love, not just our church, but the Trinity of God. So, as we begin our worship, let's listen to words of hope. Where ocean meets shore, you are there, God. Where earth meets sky, you are there, God. Where day meets night, you are there, God. And so we worship you, wonderful Counselor, wonderful Creator God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we worship you. We sing together our opening hymn, Holy, 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 Blessed Trinity. We sing together. Our worship today, we hear those famous words, let there be light. The sun is shining as I speak this morning, but I know that's going to change during the week. And yet light will still shine upon us in God's created world. Unfortunately, light has shone on some desperate things this week, and especially in the protests and the injustice that we've seen in America. Light is needed, but sometimes light skin is seen as a way of having superiority over the others, and that's got to stop. JPIT, our Peace and Justice Initiative that we share with the Baptists, and the Methodists have offered a prayer for this week. And I just want to use that as we begin our worship. Let's pray together. Loving God, as the sins of systematic racism and police brutality rear their heads once more, meet us this morning in our anger, our sorrow and frustration. Guard us from indifference, ignorance and silence. As black lives continue to be taken too soon, and because all were named and loved, we lift names to you in remembrance and resolve. George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Nelly Majinga, Darren Cumberbatch, Alonson Lewis, Sean Rigg, Mike Brown, Breonna Taylor, and so many more. As righteous anger overflows into the streets, we join in with the holy cry of "How long, O Lord?" while we pray for peace. May civility not become the enemy of justice. We lament that past protest has fallen on deaf ears and pray for a world transformed by your love. We plead for black communities, justice, safety, equality, and for those who could choose to look away, repentance, education, solidarity. Help us to declare in word and deed, Black Lives Matter. Amen. It's right that we start with that prayer. We're going to pray again as we lead into our readings for today. We're going to remember that God created a world of beauty, equality, and love. Even at the beginning of creation, the Spirit was moving, God was at work, and He created male and female, black and white, any other nation in the same way that they were created in that Garden of Eden. So as we listen and as we pray and as we sing, let's pray to Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. No words, living God, can describe you, define you, or capture you. You are more than all human language. You are beyond human understanding. Yet we glimpse you in the majesty of the universe. We sense you in the wonder of birth. We feel you in the beauty of nature. For this we adore you and praise your name.
Father, we love you, we worship and adore you. Glorify thy name in all the
Then in Jesus you show us your face, clearer than we ever deserved. A face which smiles upon us, eyes which weep with us, lips which speak forgiveness, arms which reach out to welcome us. For this we adore you and praise your name. And this is just the beginning. You never stop disclosing your purpose to us. By your Spirit, you move among us, producing unity and community, gifts of faith, hope, and love. For this, we adore you and praise your name.
The beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day.
And God said, "Let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water." So God made the vault and separated the water under the vault from the water above it. And it was so. God called the vault sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day.
And God said, "Let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear." And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds." And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kinds, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, And there was morning, the third day.
And God said, let there be lights in the vault of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them serve as signs to mark sacred times and days and years. And let them be lights in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God sent them in the vault of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day.
And God said, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the vault of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea, and every living thing with which the water teems and that moves about in it, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day.
And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make mankind in our own image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds in the sky, and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day.
Thus the heaven and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work that he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created, when the Lord God made the earth and the heavens.
Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who can fathom the spirit of the Lord, or instruct the Lord as his counsellor? Whom did the Lord consult to enlighten him? And who taught him the right way? Who was it that taught him knowledge or showed him the path of understanding? Surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket, as they are regarded as dust on the scales. He weighs the islands as though they were fine dust. Lebanon is not sufficient for altar fires, nor its animals enough for burnt offerings. Before him all the nations are as nothing. They are regarded by him as worthless and less than nothing. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn, and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson gray. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning gold. He charts the eagle's fly, commands the newborn baby's cry.
Tell the The reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. The Great Commission. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
We've heard in our readings today both beginnings and endings. We've heard those familiar words from Genesis. Right at the beginning of creation, the Spirit hovers and God is there creating. We hear the wonder of creation told by Isaiah and the power and wonder of God. Beginnings again to renew and recreate the earth, to renew and forgive the people. And then in the reading from Matthew, we hear those final words and instructions to the disciples as Jesus is prepared to go and leave them. We'll all have famous words of endings, whether they're in films, as the crux of the story emerges, and maybe in a criminal film where the finger is pointed at the real criminal in the room. Or it may be that we've heard funny stories of ending. There have been many deathbed quotes, but my favourite is this, Oscar Wilde's last words. "Either that wallpaper goes or I do." I don't know what instructions you would give your family if you're allowed to go on holiday again. If you're setting off on a really long holiday with children or grandchildren, with loved ones in a large group, what instructions would you want to give up? Perhaps there needed to be instructions about pets that need looking after. Perhaps there needs to be instructions about sticking together through the airport so that no one is left behind, as in the film Home Alone. Instructions are important. And we've heard of the final words in Matthew's Gospels today. Jesus' words to his disciples and Paul's words that we'll hear as he gives us the grace, the words we know as the grace toward the end of our worship today, both contain important instructions. The Matthew Gospel needs to be heard in a different context sometimes. So listen to these words and let them sink in.
So there we were, the 11 of us, sitting on the side of the mountain. We were there because Jesus told us to be there. And what better reason is there to be anywhere? But this time wasn't like the other times when we used to sit there waiting for him to appear with his stories, his miraculous powers, and his wonderful ways of caring for people and seeing exactly what they needed. In those times, there used to be excited crowds pressing on us, buzzing with anticipation. Then he would arrive, and there would be an expectant calm. Everyone sat waiting, listening. This time, though, it was just us, just the 11 of us, sitting on the side of a mountain. There were still some of us, you see, who were not sure what was going on. We all knew that he had been arrested after the Passover supper. Most of us had made ourselves scarce at that point, but everyone heard about what happened next, how he died, and our whole world fell apart. The story became stranger after that. Some of the women claimed to have seen him alive and well. They said the grave was empty. They said things about earthquakes and light and stones rolling away and shining people and other things none of us understood. But they said one more thing that made us pay attention. They said that he had spoken to them and that he had asked us to meet him in Galilee. So there we were, the 11 of us, sitting on the side of the mountain. And suddenly, there he was. It was amazing. We worshipped him. We couldn't believe our eyes. Jesus spoke to us about who he was, about his authority, and he told us to go and make disciples, to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and to teach them as he had taught us. So there we were, the 11 of us, sitting on the side of a mountain, about to go and fill the whole world with people who would believe in Jesus.
So, Jesus has died, the women have found the tomb empty and claim to have seen him, and now the 11 disciples, without the traitor Judas, are waiting on a hillside. We've just heard one imagining of Matthew waiting on that hillside. I wonder what you would have felt like if you were too waiting on that hillside. John and Luke's Gospels give clear accounts of Jesus meeting his disciples in Jerusalem, but Matthew omits those, while Luke gives us an account of the ascension. I wonder, would the disciples feel scared, excited, hopeful, or just downright silly? We're told a small but very important fact. When Jesus appears to them in Galilee, but some doubted. It's an extraordinary sentence. They've been through everything with Jesus, heard his promises, heard his preaching and his teaching, but then they're still not sure. They've been waiting for this, and now they see him in flesh, but there are still fragments of doubt. As I've said earlier in these series of services on YouTube, I think we can take encouragement from this, especially as Jesus didn't seem to treat the doubters any differently. And those instructions of Jesus are split into three parts. First, Jesus tells his disciples to make disciples, then to baptize them, and finally to teach them. He doesn't instruct his disciples to make converts. He tells them to make disciples, people like themselves who will commit to following Christ and state publicly that they wish to do so through the act of baptism. And those same people, even after baptism, will need to be taught how to live in God's world and obediently to that loving God. What Jesus wants his followers to do can be summarised in three challenges. They can invite others to decide to follow Christ. They can show that they really mean it. They can let him help them always. Let me say that again. Decide to follow Christ. Show they really mean it. Let him help them always. Discipleship, as the United Reformed Church keeps telling us, is an ongoing process that lasts for a lifetime. That's what walking away is all about. And as we learn how to be more like Jesus and walk in his steps, we need to trust the promise of the Spirit. Not just that promise, but the promise that Jesus will be with us always. That promise is fulfilled, I think, in the gift of the Holy Spirit to us as his believers. And in Matthew 28, Jesus promises that he will always be with us to help us, to guide us, and actively continue his work through us. Thankfully, we're not on our own, but joining in with what God has been doing all along, right back to creation, right through the stories of the Old Testament, in which Isaiah can speak of the wonders of God. And us, 2,000 plus years later, it is the Spirit who lives within us and with us that allows us to tell of God's glory. The time may be coming when we can worship together again. And yes, that will be brilliant. But when we get back, let's be disciples of Christ that tell others and show others what it means to be a follower of Christ. This is Trinity Sunday. It's the same God who creates the world, in whose name Jesus sent out his disciples. Even though that promise of the Spirit had not fully come, it's the same triune God whom Paul calls upon to bring blessing at the end of his second letter to the Corinthians. We'll hear again those words as we close. I don't know about you. It seems awesome to think that God wants people like you and me to be his mouthpiece, to be his invitee of those that need to hear his word. But that's what we are, just like those disciples. And as we go about our daily work, or maybe our daily walks as it is now, can we tell others about Christ? I think we can, because we have that boldness of the Spirit to take us out into God's world and to lead us into God's world. So, let's hear again familiar words from 1 Corinthians. And as we do so, let's take the trust, the love, the grace that God places upon us, and in his name, make disciples that love him and love the world. Amen. Holy God, we ask your blessing upon all who are baptized in the faith, that they may be witnesses to your presence and love. We pray for preachers and teachers that they may seek to reveal the mystery of your being with us. So even in these times, Lord, guide the mission and outreach of your people. Holy God, holy and strong one, hear us and help us. Holy God, we give thanks for your whole creation. Guide and bless those who work in research and who seek to discover the mysteries of your world. We remember today all the scientists and explorers, especially those helping to defeat COVID-19. We pray for all who have started back at school this week and those that remain awaiting to return to school, college or university. We ask your blessing upon all who provide us with our daily needs. Holy God, holy and strong, hear us and help us. Holy God, be among us in our homes and in our work, wherever that may take us. Surround our loved ones and ourselves with your love and protection. We ask your blessing upon those who should have been recently married and those who have a new child in their family. Holy God, holy and strong one, hear us and help us. Holy God, you are ever ready to help us. So we ask your blessings upon all the doctors, nurses, and those caring for loved ones who are ill. We remember all the ill and suffering peoples, the poor and hungry of our world, and we pray for all who feel they are without help or hope. Holy God, holy and strong, hear us and help us. Holy God, giver of life and life eternal, we rejoice in your presence and ask your blessing upon our loved ones who are departed from us. We especially remember the family of Dorothy. And as we pray and remember her and all those who have gone before us, may they share with your saints in the fullness of your glorious kingdom. So, merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. As I've suggested, our closing words come from Paul's letter, second letter to the Corinthians. Some of this we can do, but of course we can't kiss each other now. But there may be a time when we can meet, and as this passage suggests, we meet in the grace of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So listen to these words as we close our worship. Finally, brothers, and our lad sisters, goodbye. Aim for perfection, listen to my appeal, be of one mind, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints send their greetings. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
As we go into God's world, tread lightly on the earth, treasure the land, be gentle with all creatures, be generous to all people, and know that God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are drawing you deeper into their heart of love, that you may love yourself and not be afraid. Amen.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.